Alrighty folks, this is Lurch from Ireland Gaming and welcome back to another episode of From the Depths. Today, it is time to finish this thing. I have made absolutely no changes since the last video, but I have been doing some testing and working out exactly how I'm going to finish off this build and, you know, make it a little bit better. For a start, we definitely need shields, but that is something I'm going to be adding right at the very end when I know exactly how much power draw I need. I have also decided that I want to put, spinny things, daddy heli blades on it to give it a little bit extra lift, and it's, I believe daddy heli blades are more efficient for their lift compared to thrusters. I could be completely wrong. The main reason is I think it'll look pretty cool. I plan to put one on either side here, and I had planned to put one again on either side here, but I'm thinking now, because there is a slight change in the elevation here, I might remove this thruster and put a big daddy heli spinner there instead. Or even put a heli spinner and put the thruster underneath it. That might look pretty cool. So that's one thing to do. Next, troubleshooting problems. I found one thing that I changed. One of these missiles didn't have an AI. That was it. Not this one. I didn't have symmetry on when I was placing. Oh, hello. I guess it still doesn't. Oops. I could have sworn I saved this, actually. Right. On-camera troubleshooting. That's fixed. Done. Dusted. Brilliant. Next problem. If we bring the UI on, you'll see, if you look at the engine power in the bottom right, it's dipping down, and you can see there's a value of 900 there. That is the value for the battery. And the battery is being used by all of the other things on the system, and we don't want that. The battery is specifically for the real gun. So what we want to do is go down here, press Q on the battery thing, and go thump. No one is getting any power out of this. And because the magnets draw directly from the battery, they're still able to take power out of it and can still fire the railgun and charge the rails okay, but this denies everything to all of the other components on the ship, so we're not burning power inefficiently because there's an efficiency trade-off with these. If we set this to, let's say, 500.79, that means we're only getting 80% of the power that we put in, well, 79%. If we set it to zero, efficiency 1. It's not getting any power, so it doesn't matter. And that's a good way to save on fuel efficiency. And it's also stopping the battery from getting used and potentially slowing down your railgun fire if it's set to only fire when the railgun is set to 100% charge, because your battery's going to be drawing all the time. Right, that's that out of the way. What else? Oh, yes, battery charging. My engines weren't configured right. These guys were configured for maximum drive, but look at the battery charge. 0.1. We want these guys as our dedicated railgun batteries, or railgun engines. That's what these were for. So we want to have these at 1, and we'll go over and nab the other one and set you to 1. So that means that these guys are only going to be charging the batteries, and all of their power, whenever the battery is in deficit, will be dedicated to charging the battery. Next, we need to find this guy, which is the other engine. There's a red line. We'll get Q in here, and this is set to 1 battery charge, and that's because that's what it was set to when I prefabbed it. I actually want to set this down to 0.03. That'll be plenty. I really don't want this thing to be using, well, to be actually feeding any power, because this is really for all of our other components. So this means that this setup at the back, these two mule engines that are either side here, and the battery bank is sort of like one independent system. I mean, the other bits can, like the other components, like the ammo control or ammo processors and stuff, can still draw out of the mules, but it's only as a sort of secondary thing, and the majority of their power is going straight into the batteries. Now, what else? Oh, yes. This is one thing I noticed as well. Well, for a start, I've got way too many thrusters. I don't need this many. And we will be drawing that down, especially whenever we add heli blades. But these, the PID is using these for upwards thrust, and I don't want that. So I'm going to take these and put them up here instead. Oh, sorry, it's a little bit framey. All these thrusters are very framey. That's actually one of the reasons that I wanted to remove some of them. We want to set all of these on the right to roll right-hand side, and all of the ones on the left to roll left-hand side. And this is important because there is less demand for down thrust because we have batteries, so the PID is very rarely going to be using down thrust. The problem that was happening before was these were being completely used up by the PID for altitude, and the roll wasn't able to tune the roll whenever it wanted to, so the two PIDs were fighting over the actual control. Now, because the downward facing thrusters aren't really going to be used that much, this frees up the roll PID to completely use these whenever it wants. So just bear that in mind whenever you're actually placing your PIDs or using multiple like this. They can fight over the thrusters that they're using, and it can be an absolute pain in the bum to actually make them work the way you want them to, because they fight over them all the time, but it can be done. There are ways and means. For something like this, this works. Now, to be honest, I am making it really difficult for myself using PIDs for this, because there are many, many Lua AIs that would do this job much better and much, much, much easier, because I could just copy-paste code and set an altitude, and that would work straight out of the box. With the PIDs and the AI, constant battle of tweaking thruster placement, you know, thrust balancing isn't a thing, so we have to fight for it. But I just wanted to show the fact that you can do it with the stock AI. The PIDs make a lot of new things possible, which is really, really great. But right, okay, we've nattered long enough. I do actually want to add a big thruster here at the back, just for pitch control, because this is the one that seems to be used all the time. But, right, what do we want to do first? I'm going to put a thruster there. Ooh, framing. We're going to put a couple of daddy spinners on the bottom here. And I'm going to remove a bunch of these thrusters and pull them back a bit so that A, we have less lag, and B, well, we're not wasting as many resources. That'd be nice. But right now, I'm going to start building. So I'm going to cut here and we'll go to a buildy montage thing. So I'll see you in the montage and speak to you after. Okay, time to configure these things. These are only the basic ones. I'm going to stick another one on the back in here. But I brought you back just to get these guys started and show you what I'm actually going to do with them. Now, I want to queue on this, and we want to set the always up fraction to 1. This means that no matter what direction these things are pointing, the force will always apply directly upwards. And if we have enough of these things, I'm going to try and balance enough forward and back, it will actually give us a fairly stable flight. Now, I'm also going to give it a little bit of motor drive, and let's add to 5, because that's quite a bit. I think you get diminishing returns on this as well, but for this one, we're going to use 5, and I'm going to set this on the other side as well. I'm going to set you to 5 and full. Right. Moment of truth. We need to set an ACB up to control these. Where did I put it? I've lost it. Now these, I can't remember if these are the opposite direction or not. A handy way to make things always be active is activate when altitude greater than input, and set this to negative 500 because it can't go below 500. It's sort of a nice way to force it rather than using activate every input seconds, because then you get downtime. Spin blocks I want to set, and I also want to set this. This guy's about here, I think, so... just don't want it to affect this. That's important. And we want to set the rotation speed to... And let's see what direction the force is going. It's going upwards. That's good. That is the important thing. We also need to do this here. Activate when altitude greater than... Minus 5,500. I want spin blocks, set rotation speed to maximum. Actually, I want you to be a bit shorter too. And are you going upwards? Hurrah! Sweet, that works. Even though they're both spinning the same direction. That's cool. Right, now I also want to have another one underneath here. I'm going to try and mount this. I should be able to do something crafty and get this mounted underneath the spin block so that it looks like it's attached to it. Back to building. Okay, I brought you back for a super sneaky building trick. This is one that Ruger taught me. If there's ever somewhere that you can't place a block because it won't let you based on the connectors, what you want is a 1x1 prefab. You grab the part that you want using your 1x1 prefab, move it to the position that you would like it to be in, and go click. And all of a sudden, it will attach just about bloody anywhere. You can make these do all sorts of janky weird stuff. And yeah, awesome trick. Use it all the time, especially for like putting chairs down in unusual places normally, actually, which is a bit of an unusual one, but okay. But yeah, this is more or less done. I do need an ACB here to get this guy moving, which shouldn't be too hard. There's a room in here. This is this room, right. Don't really want that here. Hang on, I put a block in here. I did. No, I don't want to break that beam for it. I'm going to find a home for an ACB. You're going here. Because I can't be bothered finding anywhere else for you. Now, this should be enough range. Activate when altitude greater than minus 500. Spin blocks, set rotation speed. No, actually, negative. Negative 30, because I built this the opposite way around. Reason I did that is because whenever spin blocks are all rotating in the same direction, you exert a rotational force on your craft. And the reason I'm doing two separate ones in the other direction is to sort of nullify that change. Not sure if that actually applies to daddy heli spinners, but it does apply to spin blocks. Well, precision ones at least. And we'll set you to 6 because he's actually got less rotors. Moment of truth. Feel. Because we have too much lift at the front of the ship. Do we? We do. Oh, well, yeah, because these actually provide a lot of lift. So, you are going to have to move back. Do we still have too much lift? We do. Right, this could take a little bit of fiddling, so I'm going to cut here, do some fiddling, and be right back. Well, that took a little less fiddling than I thought whenever I figured out what the problem was. I actually built these backwards. In other words, I built them the right way round, and they should be rotating clockwise. And I had them set to rotate negatively, and I was pulling the arch of the ship into the water. That was the problem. Now it's fixed, and it flies. It flies lovely. It's class. Did I set your always up for action? I did. I've got the back one here set to 4, and the front two, I think, are set to 4 as well. So this is actually providing unbalanced lift, but it all kind of works out in the end. I honestly think that this looks a little bit daft, but I have a potential solution for that. But that's going to come in the cosmetic part. And there's going to be lots of little fiddly tweaks and changes to how this thing looks. But I think the next thing we should probably do is add some shields. Now that it's flying quite nicely. Actually, just let's test this quickly to see if it flies forward okay. Come on, off you go, Sonny Jim. Combat AI would help. How are you going? That seems to work okay. Pretty stable. Little bit of roll. But there's plenty of juice in those thrusters because they have all of their thrust available to compensate for the roll. So that's really, really great. Love it. Okay. Everything seems to be working hunky-dory now. That per Kalmar is getting it. Oh. Things pretty epic. I know some people were saying to add a bunch more thrusters, make it faster. I actually think I'm going to cut them back. I might just leave it at 4. 40 meters per second is pretty fast for a land vehicle, or for a water vehicle, so it's about the same speed as the Bulldog. It's not set up to stay too far away from the enemy, though. Because, I mean, it's a close combat. It's a freaking tank. Like, it's got double layer armor. It's going to have an awful lot of shields. We've got about 1800 power for shields, so that's not a lot. I would like to have a bit more available, but it's going to have to do for now. One other thing I noticed is we haven't got enough fuel, and if I spawn this in the water, as I will do now, into the water, son. Oh, you can. Can you get out of the water now? Oh, can you get out of the water? See if we can get him into the water. There you go. Ah, there we go. Okay. So, he gets disabled or something like that. He won't be able to, you know, get himself out of the water. That really sucks. But I have worked out a solution. First up, the. Alright, let's turn it to patrol mode and you'll see how I plan to do this. We don't want the map, we want this. Get you, select, and input to patrol mode will tell me to go forward. Come on. There we go. So he can go forward, which is very interesting. Well, what can you use forward momentum for in water? Hydrofoils. I'm going to bolt a whole crap ton of hydrofoils underneath the center of mass. In fact, do you know what? This literally only takes a second. An interesting thing about hydrofoils I find is that they actually work. The PID will actually use them as pitch controllers, which is quite funny, but not what we want here. I'm going to need an ACB to make it do what I want it to do. Now, I have nothing to actually attach this to. That sucks a little. Well, we're going to have to make something, aren't we? Or center of mass. Can't see it. Roughly there. Okay. Get you there. And put a load of hydrofoils there. And forget to put on symmetry. Well done, Lurch. Well done. Now we have hydrofoils that are currently, if you look at them, trying to pitch us up because the PID controller says so. Let's get an ACB down to override that and make sure that it always stays pointing upwards. And again, activate when altitude is less than minus 500, set that to 45 degrees, test you, and you should be giving us a little bit of lift. Not enough lift. That'll just give us more lift. Enough lift. Not enough lift. Let us give us more lift. See what I'm doing here? It's overriding it. Why is it overriding it? Activate when altitude is less than 5. Less than. Pa. Greater than. Did that backwards. Well done. Come. Oh, you're at the waypoint now. This thing's making an idiot of me. Come on, you. Are you going to work for me now? Please work. Come on. Come on! Crap, dude. I know you can do this. I still need more lift. Are you serious? How many frickin' hydrofoils do we need? Nope. Come on. All I need is to get the bloody nose out of the water. Yeah, just... Oh! We're away! Sweet, at last. I just needed enough lift. Okay. Right, that's the solution. Do you know what this rate? I gotta use bloody balloons. Although that means I need to put another, like a balloons or water start algorithm thingy in. And balloons look a bit derpy, to be honest. Especially on a tank. I mean, this is kind of stylish, you know. Something a little bit different. But yeah, anyway, all that faffing about later, it is time to do cosmetic stuff. So rather than doing that all on camera, because that's going to take a while, I'm just going to do this all off camera and we will cut and do a magic act. And all of a sudden, we'll have a prettier looking ship. Just having a quick test flight after making a couple of cosmetic changes. Just little slopey bits here and there. I added a skirt around the thrusters. Changed the hydrofoils up a little bit. I got rid of the bar down the middle. And yeah, it's looking pretty dashing. After it gets its paint job, which is coming up very soon, but I just realized I forgot to do something kind of important. Never added the shields. Also never added any repair bots. And I'm going to do that now. So, I'm going to stop talking and speedy. Rawr! Okay, I think that's about enough for now. That'll do. It'll do. Now all it needs is a paint job. Oh, I do want to put one on the back though. I want to put a shield on the back and then it's paint job time and then I think we're pretty much done. Yeah. Right. We got a plan. Onwards. We're so close to finishing this build. Oh my god, it's been ages. Okay. Painting complete. Shields complete. Weapons complete. I've even figured out a name. Someone suggested this and it was actually something I was going to save for a different vehicle. Maybe the second Fetcher in my campaign. But we've already got a second Fetcher and it's called Fetcher. So I'm going to use this here instead. Meet Falcor. For anyone that doesn't know, Falcor was the flying luck dragon that was in the never-ending story who really looked rather a lot more like a dog, to be honest. So this is Falcor and I think I'm going to use this guy on the in the campaign as well, and he'll join the Arlan attack or the Arlan Warhounds and probably help us out pretty well in the campaign. He's pretty tough. It's got really heavily armored, heavily layered armor. I mean, we've got two layers of metal here around this. There's two layers here along the sides. The nose is double layer thick. We've got lots of shields now, and I even added some funky lighting for cool effects. Oh yeah. So yeah, I'm pretty happy with how this turned out. It was a much, much longer build than I anticipated, but I hope you've enjoyed it all. It seems a lot of people like the PID tweaking and stuff like that, and I'll try and show off more of that sort of stuff in the future. Because, you know, the PID in particular is a very scary block, but it really shouldn't be. Just play with it. Try and break stuff. And, you know, you'd be amazed what you can actually learn. But yeah, I'm pretty happy with this guy so far, and I am running pretty low on time because this did take a lot longer. So I'm going to stop talking, I'm going to put this guy on the workshop. I do hope you like it. Have a little bit of a play around. The final cost ended up at 438k. Not too shabby. And it seems to be pretty damn effective. But of course, we have to move on to the obligatory montage, right? So, without further ado, I'm going to move on to the montage, and I'll wrap the episode up now. I do really hope you enjoyed it. Any likes, subs, or comments are really, really awesome. I love hearing from you guys, and I read every single comment. As always, take it handy, and have a bloody good day.